Jackie, I have a question for you.
How are you doing? Was a little difficult.
Yeah, that
kind of flew off the shelves. But
because everybody was making it.
That's right. But you know, figured it was hanging in a closet. That's all right.
Nice.
It doesn't go to waste that way. Really regretting the decision to wear a long sleeve black shirt and long sleeve pants tonight. We're going out of ball. I'm thinking about finding the nearest body of water and inserting myself into it. Before, like after this, but before I clean anything up, I'll be like, amen. And then go into the river for a minute and boats though, it's
no,
a
fun
day for it.
Did your wife leave? I was gonna say hi to her.
Oh, she's over in the car. She's in the air conditioning.
She's smart, yeah.
Hi.
Alright. Oh, can you wave? Well, can you say hi?
Hi.
So,
last year?
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 Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last year? Last
there's a piece of that you want to see me play this. Cheryl.
That way you can do it.
Oh, wait. Oh,
that's my
bad.
Get loud, so I will do my best to make the volume, adjust the volume appropriately here on my mixer, but if things happen and I get a little bit loud, I apologize ahead of time. I also want to let you know that there are parts of this that have already begun to not happen as planned. We had planned to have a projection. I used to have this wonderful projector that had this marvelously bright light. And I still have the wonderful projector, but it no longer has a marvelously bright light. And so it turns out that the projection, which was going to project the liturgy over here or over there or something, we don't have. I don't know whether you were able to download or print out the bulletins that were online or if you have a digital copy, but I do have a paper copy of the liturgy of the bulletin. If anybody would like one, just let me know and I can hand them out.
You got a copy?
I have a copy. In fact, may I hand you all the copies?
All right, okay.
So if anybody needs one, let us know. So that's one thing. I'm waiting. Now I'm just sort of passing time up here talking until 10 o'clock. The live stream is going to kick in. And actually, we've been doing a little bit of press the live stream button is actually pressed.
Yeah, it looks like it is.
So. Make it better the next time through. do have a couple of announcements that I wanted to mention. I have a meeting on Tuesday morning, so I will not be in office hours on Tuesday morning. But I will be doing the office hours at Tunnel City on Thursday from 9 to 11, weather permitting. If it is raining, I'll be doing virtual office hours. If it's nice out, I'll be at Tunnel City sitting outside and taking. So anyone who'd like to come by, that'll be on Thursday between 9 and 11. I also want to remind you that there is a directions team meeting on Tuesday at 7 o'clock, so anybody who's on the directions team will be meeting Tuesday at 7 o'clock. I also want to remind you that on our website now we have a prayer request to sign up. So if you have a prayer request, there is a conservative celebration. You can go to the website and you can fill it out. That will be communicated to the prayer team. Then communicate to me or to everybody as appropriate. Some people don't communicate everybody on the web form, and it'll be just held within the confines of their community. And there's also a place on the website you can sign up to liturgies, to read scripture, to participate in worship. Worship is liturgy, literally comes from the Greek meaning the word of the people, and it's all of us together that make this world. I also want to, once again, offer you an opportunity to discuss any other ways of being in fellowship or discipleship together that you may have. If you want to, if you're interested in a Bible study or a small group of some sort, please, let's talk and let's see what we can do. Just because we have to be isolated doesn't mean we can't continue to deepen our discipleship and bring others into a relationship with Christ. Seems like a lot of announcements, and I would offer the opportunity for anybody else who might have something they want to share, but I'm not really sure how to do that safely. So if you do have anything that you'd like to communicate, let us know, and we'll send it out on the email list, and whatever ways you have of being in touch together, we'll make use of. Having gone through that, I want to give us all a moment to center ourselves in prayer before we continue with our worship. So we pray, Lord, no matter how strong the storm or how threatening the wave, Jesus calls us to trust and love and mercy. Rejoice in his goodness, rely on his power in all things, and in his name we pray this morning. This was the part where we were going to sing This Is The Day, but since we don't have the projection of our lyrics, we're going to This Is The Day a little bit later in the service, and instead we're going to begin with a call to worship. Will you join me in the call to worship? Sunshine and celebration, rain and remembrance, all are part of the richness of God's mercy and love for us. Welcome this day to a celebration of these blessings. Lord, open your hearts and Lord, open our hearts and spirits to your love. Let's pray together the opening prayer. God of mysterious ways, you take our fears and turn them into triumphs. You remind us that you are always with us. Fear the wind and the waves of life. Encourage us to step out of the boat, to come across these difficulties to your redeeming and transforming love. Give us courage and strength, joy and peace for all the times ahead. Amen. And now let's sing together, This Is The Day. You don't have the lyrics in front of you, but I reckon you probably all know this one, right?
This is the day, this is the day.
loving steadfastness of God, the enduring faithfulness of God's love for us, and the assurance that no matter how far we stray, no matter what we might do, God is always there to forgive us, to uplift us, to uphold us, and remind us that we are God's beloved children. And we need that, right? We need that assurance because we try to do what's right, we try to do what God would have us do, but we don't always succeed, do we? Sometimes we fall short. I don't know about you, but if I tried to keep track of all the times I fell short, well, there just aren't enough check boxes in a pad of paper to keep track of all the ways I've messed up in my life. But that's okay, we're human. We were built to be who we are. God knows that we're never going to be perfect, and God doesn't expect perfection. God expects us to be perfect in love, as God is perfect in love for us. And in that perfection of love, every time we come to God confessing that we've messed up, God forgives us, and God loves us, and God reminds us that there is nothing we can do that can separate us from God. So let's confess this morning, let's confess to God that we're not perfect. Lord, please forgive our weakness and our lack of trust in you. We are like the disciples who, in the midst of fears and storms, could only tremble and wonder about the threat of us. Even when Jesus called to the disciples, they shook with fear. But Jesus offered words of encouragement. The calls of Peter asked Jesus to call and make them come out of the boat. Jesus complied and Peter stepped over the edge onto the waves. Fear claimed him again and he began to sink. Many of us can identify with that moment when we let go of our faith and push on to our fears. Help us to place our trust totally in you, your call to us. You will guide and lift us to safety. That is the promise you've given us, and we believe. When our faith slips, scoop us up and bring us to peace. Friends, keep your focus on Jesus. He is your Savior and will never fail you. Rejoice, dear friends, you are called precious by our Lord. Amen. 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 Now, we have the scripture readings from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 and 33.
Meanwhile, oh.
I gotta tell you, it's a beautiful morning, but right now I am seriously regretting the decision to wear a long sleeve black shirt and jeans. It is a beautiful day though, isn't it? It's a gorgeous day. And I'm just glad that you're here this morning. This is something that we thought we'd try. And I think that we're going to continue to try this and maybe improve on the experience. Each time we do it, make it a little bit better and a little bit fuller experience. Particularly to those who are watching the live stream. Again, I apologize. There were some people that didn't count the way we're hoping they would, but I promise for next time, they will. So here's my question. Have you ever done something so out of control, audacious, that you don't really have any idea how you didn't end up either in a hospital bed or in a jail cell? Have you ever done anything like that? Something just so crazy, not bad necessarily, but, you know, crazy, audacious, just out of control. Have you ever done something that crazy and yet have it turn out to be mostly okay, and you just don't know how it got there? When I was 18, I bought my first motorcycle. It was a 1972 Honda CB450, and I loved that bike. It was a beautiful bike. Yeah, it wasn't a big bike, but it was a beautiful bike. It was just a treat to ride. But at first, I have to confess, it was a very scary experience when I first bought that. When I first bought that bike, I had no experience riding a motorcycle, and I didn't know what I was doing. I'd taken a class, and I'd gotten my license. The real riding experience out on the road, I didn't have any. The first time I was riding that bike out, I was excited. When I passed a couple of other people riding motorcycles, if you've ever ridden a motorcycle or you've really paid attention to people in the car, you know that when bikers pass other bikers on the street, there is a wave. Sometimes it's above the handlebars, sometimes it's below the handlebars. For the very first time I passed other motorcycles going the other direction on the road, I was so excited to wave that I waved with my right hand. Now, if you don't ride a motorcycle, that may not seem like a lot to you, but if you do, you know that the right hand controls the throttle. And so, I'm riding down the road, and there's those people passing me, and I went to wave, and I almost lost it. Interestingly enough, those bikes that I waved to, they kind of turned around, they did a U-turn, they pulled up, they guided me off the road, and they're like, "New rider?" I said, "Well, yeah." And we spent the rest of the afternoon riding together. It was actually a great experience, but that's not what I'm here to talk about. That's another story for another time, actually. What I want to talk about this morning is the story of the day I bought the motorcycle. I bought it from a friend of my brother's, and he didn't live near where we lived. It was maybe a 45-minute drive away from my house. So I had my mom drop me off at this guy's house in my arrogance. I thought, sure, I'll just buy the bike and ride it home. Right? How hard can this be? Which would have been fine, except instead of choosing to ride home on slow roads where I could be a little bit more modest, I decided to see what it felt like to ride a motorcycle for the first time on the highway. To get it going fast and feel the wind. Except I'd never ridden on a highway before. I'd never ridden on a road before. I'd never been out on the street, ever. So I saw it once or twice getting up on the road. This was all happening in Pittsburgh, and Pittsburgh is all hills and mountains. And getting it started on the hill a couple times, I stalled out. But once I got going, I was fine, and it felt great. And I hit the on-ramp for Interstate 279, and I just opened it up, and it was amazing. Never felt anything like that. It was exhilarating, thrilling. Wow, it was great. I was up in fourth gear, and I decided to swerve into the fast lane to pass the cars ahead of me, and the bike just died. It just died. And there was traffic. And the traffic started to fly by me way too close, and I started to hear horns and people beating out, giving me a different kind of wave out their windows. And I twisted the throttle and nothing happened. I downshifted, I tried again, nothing, of course, nothing happened. I was losing control of a bike that was starting to swerve in the lane as I panicked. And some voice in the back of my head said, "Hey, idiot, you're out of gas. Switch to the reserve." I said, "That's right, that's it, I must be out of gas." So I was safely to a pump, but I didn't know where the reserve was. I thought I just bought this bike. I had no idea where the reserve was. So I looked down and I saw the reserve switch. And I completely lost control of the bike. I put the switch to the reserve, but as I was doing it, my bike moved very quickly from the fast lane where the cars were dodging around me to the slow lane, you know, the lane into which the cars were changing in order to dodge around me. That was maybe the closest I've ever been to dying. And it was also the most terrified I've ever been on a motorcycle, right up until the time I rode my motorcycle down from Mount Washington to New Hampshire in the snow. And that, too, is another story for another time. My accidental swerve, which was accompanied by screeching tires from cars, and it took me into and then through the slow lane and onto the shoulder. But somehow I had to flip the switch to reserve, and I no sooner got on the shoulder than the bike roared to life again, and I was able to wait till my heart stopped pounding, and then find a gas station, and then I made it home. I decided to ride the bike that morning was something I could do, and I could do well, despite my lack of experience, or any real reason to think I was safe on two wheels. But I saw other people out there riding, and I wanted it. I wanted to be riding myself, and I thought, hey, I can do that. Sure, I can ride. I can have that fun. I can share that experience. I see everybody else doing it. I see other people doing it. So I think I can do it too. You know, sometimes I think that for the disciples, following Jesus must have been like that. Just a little bit. They saw him work miracles, and I wonder if they wondered maybe that they'd someday be able to do that too. They'd seen him heal the blind and the lame, and they'd seen him heal all manner of illnesses. They'd seen him cast out demons. And just before this story, they saw him feed, 12,000 people with 5 loaves and a couple of fish? I wonder if they wondered, hey, will I be able to do that too? I mean, actually, he told them they would, right? In John chapter 14, verse 12, he said, very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than these. Greater things than Jesus was doing? Greater things? No wonder they thought they were in for such a wild ride. Jesus healed the sick, fed the blessed, cast out demons, and they do greater things? And in Matthew 10, he sent them out to prepare his way, to cure the sick, to raise the dead, and to preach that the kingdom was near. But between then and today's gospel, which was a few chapters later, we don't really know for sure what any of them did. But we know that Jesus summoned the 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and cure every disease and every sickness. We do know that, despite their hopes and fears, despite their dreams, despite their expectations of what was to come and who they what role they have in what was to come. We know they were still uncertain and still a little afraid. And we know they were still a lot timid. So maybe they experienced the power of God using themselves as vessels. And maybe they only thought one day, hey, maybe we will be able to do those things, just not today. Who can blame them? That's a lot of pressure put on a bunch of Christian people, trained folk, that they do all the things that Jesus did and more if they just jumped right in and said, we got this, I got this, let's go. That would have been audacious. Jumping straight in with both feet to raise the dead and cure blindness and heal the lepers, that would have been out of control audacious. But as far as we can tell, that's not how they started. As far as I can tell, they didn't jump right into the big stuff, the crazy, audacious, change the world kind of stuff. It seems like they started out with something tame, something small. Peter saw Jesus walking out to them on the water and thought, hey, curing the sick is big, casting out demons is giant, and raising the dead would just be out of control, amazing. But maybe I'm not ready for that. But here comes Jesus walking on the water to meet us. And walking on the water? Walking on the water? Walking out to meet them halfway? Maybe I can do that. I can do that much, can't I? Can't I do something that big, that crazy? Can I start here? Maybe see what happens. So we try. Thank you. No, that wasn't the long-term goal. It wasn't the dream, the home run, the finish line. Pick your sports metaphor. But it was someplace to start. We all know what that's like, don't you? Starting with a dream so big, so out of control that you don't know maybe that you'll ever really see it to fruition. Might be a new job, a new career, something that captures your spirit, that excites you, but maybe takes you out of your comfort zone. Maybe it's an adventure, a hike. Anyone feel like hiking the Appalachian Trail? If 2,200 miles is a little too long, maybe the Superior Hiking Trail from Lake Superior in Duluth to the Canadian border. That one's only about 296 miles, although it still seems pretty out of control to me. Maybe it's a drive-in worship service where you have a projection with the liturgy and you have music piped directly into a live stream so that people who are here and people who aren't can have the same experience. Church building, a cafe with a teaching kitchen and a garden and a worship space and offices for nonprofits, maybe a hostel on the third floor, cold storage for the farmer's market in the basement, a huge building with a church name on it, but so much more, a community resource and a blessing to the community. But those things can be hard, especially when they require more than just vision and faith, when they require the incredible hard back-breaking work of labor and money, a lot of money. And when it doesn't happen right away or within a certain time frame or when the miles don't go by under our boots as quickly as they want, or when the new job or even the interview for the new job turns out to be a little bit more daunting and frightening than we thought it would be, we can lose heart. We can get scared and we can panic and we can even despair. We might even be tempted to call out like Peter did, "Lord, save me." But again, maybe you don't want to call that out, do you? Because what happened to Peter when Peter called out, "Lord, save me"? Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him, saying, "You man of weak faith, why did you begin to have doubt?" Yikes. I don't want Jesus to say that about me, right? Do I really want to hear Jesus say that to me? But I think we really need to look at what Jesus was saying. Now, every time I've heard somebody preach this passage, they say Jesus was rebuking Peter because his faith was weak, and the proof of his weak faith was that he started to walk on water and then he began to sink. But come on, that's not fair, right? Come on, Jesus, isn't that fair? I mean, there was a storm raging. The disciples were scared. The boat was being battered by the waves, and they were far out from land. You know, just this spring, I had an opportunity to go to the Holy Land on a pilgrimage with some colleagues and the bishop. It was a wonderful time. If it had happened 2 weeks later, I never would have made it. It was right before the world ended. And we managed to go, and we spent 10 days, and we came back. And there were a lot of different things you really can't tell about the Holy Land. They take you to this big plain, and they say, "This is where David fought Goliath." We don't really know. They take you to this house in Nazareth, and they say, "This is where Jesus lived." They take you to a house in Bethlehem and they say, "This is where Jesus was born," but they don't. There's even two different places, two commercially huge places, that both claim they were the place where Jesus was laid for 3 days in a tomb. Our guide even acknowledged this. One of his favorite sayings while we were over there was, "Well, if it's not here, it's near." But the whole trip became, I don't know, holy for me, real for me, the day we went out on the Sea of Galilee. You can question whether or not that was the plane where David fought Goliath. You can question whether this was the tomb where Jesus was laid. But the Sea of Galilee is the Sea of Galilee. I mean, it is what it is. You can't be like, "Well, maybe it was a different Sea of Galilee." It was the only one there was. And we were out on the sea, and it was a beautiful day. And for me, knowing that those weren't the same water molecules, there weren't the same fish in the ocean, but it was the same sea, for me, it became real. That was a calm day, and I really wish we had the projection here because I was going to show you a video that they took of me. My beard was significantly longer at the time. It was this huge, unkempt thing, and it was a totally calm day on the Sea of Galilee, and yet the beard was just blowing all over the face. We call it it wasn't a windsock, it was a beard sock, and it was just out of control on a calm day. Even on the calmest of days, the Sea of Galilee is out of control. This wasn't a calm day. This was a stormy day. This was a day when the disciples were sailing fish on that sea all the time are terrified for their lives. How could Jesus have come down on Peter because he was afraid in that moment? It just wouldn't be fair. And it certainly wouldn't be compassionate. But here's the thing, I don't think that that's what Jesus was rebuking. I don't think Jesus was rebuking Peter because he started to sink. I don't think he was rebuking him because he started to sink. I think Jesus was rebuking him that his faith was so shallow that he panicked and that he cried out, "Lord, help me." That for some reason Peter thought that he had to cry out to the Lord, as if he didn't have enough faith to realize that Jesus was going to save him anyway. Jesus was right there with him. You think Jesus would let Peter's audacious attempt to come alongside by letting Peter drown? By allowing him to die? Jesus was right there with him, beside him. Focus of his faith and the source of the miracle. Jesus was there with him. Jesus was by his side. He might not have instantly been successful in everything that he did, but throughout his life and his ministry, Peter knew that Christ was with him, and he never had to doubt him. Except maybe he doubted just before. You know, sometimes we doubt it too. Sometimes we doubt whether Jesus is with us when we try these crazy, awful, all audacious things, and they don't work out. Sometimes we wonder where Christ is in our experience. Let me tell you, sisters and brothers, Jesus is here with us. Jesus is at work here among us. Jesus is going to be by our side no matter what we do and no matter how we do it. Jesus is going to be able to take what we offer, however we offer it, however audacious it is, however humble it is. Whether it's the big dream, the grand plan, the swing for the fences, the touchdown pass, or whether we're just going to try to get up on our shaky legs and take one step out of the boat, Jesus is going to accept what we have to offer and bless it and help us to use it for God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And it's okay for us to call out to God in our fear and our uncertainty. It's okay to call out to God when we don't know how we're going to make it happen or if we're going to be able to make it happen. In fact, I would argue that it's necessary to call out to God for guidance as we decide how we proceed in all the things that we do, and to call out to God for the courage to persevere and make our visions a reality. But we never have to call out to God to rescue us, not from our decisions, not from our fears, not from our ultimate uncertainty. We never have to save us, because God has already saved us. And God will save us again and again through Christ. No matter how many times we fall and fail, God will pick us up through Christ and Christ's unconquerable, undeniable, unbeatable grace. So, back for a moment to the sports metaphors, to the home runs, touchdowns, to the record breaking paces, to back to the motorcycles with just enough reserve tank to get their inexperienced riders to safety, back to the career changes we both come to fear and the adventures we both long for and dread, back to Peter, who will one day raise the dead, but who, just at this point, is trying for something a little bit smaller, to walk out and meet his master on the water. It's okay to start smaller, to scale back a bit, because let's face it, walking on water may not be the dream. But it's a heck of a good start. Take a look at this building, at the possibilities here, the dreams that are bound up in this space. But I think we need to acknowledge that maybe we can't go for the full miracle right now. That we need to maybe scale back the grand dream of teaching pitches and functioning cafes, and then fund our ministries here and in the community and hostels and cold storage. Maybe we need to acknowledge that right now we're not ready to feed the 12,000 and 5 loaves and a couple of fish. But maybe we can build a home. Maybe we can build a space where we can meet and be a community together, where we can establish ourselves as part of this community and open our doors to those who come seeking comfort and shelter, a break from the pressure of the now, and a reminder that God's love is in the old. And nothing prohibits the dream. nothing ends the full-scale, audacious, out-of-control dream. Grief makes it harder to achieve. But it does acknowledge that we can be a blessing to a community in an incredible number of ways before we fulfill all of those. By starting not with raising dead and clearing the land, not with a full coffee shop teaching kitchen and a fully dressed-out worship space, but with a space, a place to gather and a place to be, a place for us to call home, and a place for us to experience Christ in our midst and in the midst of the community, a place to remember that Jesus is with us, that Jesus is in and part of all we do in Jesus' name, blessing us and the community we serve in all the ways in which we serve. And a place to remember what might yet be. To be reminded that while Peter started out, you know, walking and then sinking on the water, Peter did end up healing the sick. Peter did end up curing the blind. And yes, Peter even ended up raising the dead in Jesus' name. And we can do that too. We may start with only a little walking on water, getting here, being a light and a place for hope in the community. But with the Spirit of Christ in our corner, what might start out small can continue to build and grow and develop and work to bring about the fullness of the vision and the embodiment of grace and the fulfillment of new hope in our world. No matter what we do, no matter how we approach life, service to Christ, Christ will see our gift and honor our gift and bless our gift and bless the community to which we give. Amen. Amen. Normally, at this place, and this is weird, like, I thought preaching to a camera was weird, like in an empty room. Preaching in a camera was weird, but this is even weirder because I see these cars and I know there's people in them, but the sunlight is reflecting the sky back to me, and so it looks like I'm just preaching at empty cars. And the cars are blurry. They're freaking me out a little bit. Anyway, this is the part of the service normally where we would, under normal circumstances, where we have everybody sitting in pews or hey, how you doing? Where we'd have everybody sitting in pews, or we'd walk around a collection plate. We're not going to do that today, obviously. But we do acknowledge that the things that we do in this community rely on the support of this community to keep us going. And so there are numerous ways that we can contribute to the mission that we have here at New Hope. We can send an offering to the offices at 550 West Main Street. Right, that's right, right? 550 West Main Street? Yeah, sure, 550 West Main Street. You can give online, either using your bank account or a credit card. You can send it right from our website. There's a number of ways that you can support this mission that we have together and the mission that we're trying to build together to move into the future. And so I just thank you for your support. Thank you for the ways that you are going to work to help make New Hope a new hope for this community. The richness of God's mercy is poured over us every minute of our lives, even when we least expect it. And so the gifts that we do offer and the tithes that we give are in gratitude for all that God does for and with us, so that we might be a better servants of the gospel in Jesus' name. Now, thank you. become an offertory prayer, I think, quickly in your morning, so let's pray that together now. Lord of sea and storm, of sunshine and meadow, we present these offerings as tokens of our lives and grateful praise for your love for us. Use these gifts for the ministries of hope and justice in this new book of the world, we ask. Again, this is another regret that I'm wearing a long sleeve shirt, and it's black, and it's really quite cold here. Anyway, another thing we haven't figured out how to do yet is how to take prayer requests if they don't come in email or over the web. So I'm going to just offer a prayer for us, and it's just going to be a general prayer, and I'm going to give us, again, time in the middle of the prayer to lift up those things that we keep in our hearts. So I'll be praying. God of grace and mercy, God of calmness in the storm, and the God who helps us weather the storms when they can't be becalmed. You are by our side in everything that we do. You are the master of our lives. You are the founder of the peace. You are the one to whom we give our devotion because you have given yourself for us. Your unconquerable love has sacrificed for us in so many ways, and we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice to you as we work to bring your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we exist these days in the midst of a terrible pandemic, and there are those who are sick and suffering, and those even who have recovered but have not fully recovered. We ask that you give them all strength and healing. We ask for your wisdom on the doctors, the scientists who are desperately working to find a vaccine and a cure. For the nurses and all the other care professionals who put themselves in harm's way to give you comfort to your people. We also pray that you reach into your communities and find those who are vulnerable, those who are at risk, that you lift them up and remind them that they are not alone, and that you show us the way that we can be of service to those who are among the lost, the last and the least, as Jesus calls us to reach out in love and in your name to serve them. Lord, there are just so many things that we pray for. We pray for peace, and we pray for an end to the discord and the rhetoric of hate and injustice in our country. There are so many things that break our hearts as we look around the world in which we live. Silent to you this morning, there are more things in our hearts that maybe don't even have the courage to pray silently, but we know we can lay them all on you. Though we may not have spoken or whispered or fought them directly, we know that you hear them anyway. And so even for those prayers that we fear to offer, there is one prayer that we do offer, and it is the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us. Let's pray. Father, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. The storms of life are going to come. The storms are going to come in the days when we least expect it. The storms are going to come. Sometimes it's getting stormy on the horizon, but often the storms aren't going to make any sense to us, and we're not going to be able to anticipate the damage they can do in our lives and in our world. And sometimes when we're going strong and we're building up momentum, those storms come and knock us off. And we're even afraid to maybe just put one foot out of the boat and take a step. But whatever we do, God is with us. God is there to guide us. God is there to show us God's love and God's grace. And God is there to uphold us through everything we have to experience. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and abide with you forevermore. And all of God's children stay together. Amen. As we conclude our worship this morning, let's give thanks to God. Let's sing number 2036, give thanks. And I apologize if you don't have the words, but maybe you know this one. And we'll join together.
Thank you. You're welcome. Were you able to hear everything?
Yeah.
Good.
You can still hear it.
That's an excellent point.
Did you already turn the stream off?
Yeah, I did.